Okay, let's go to the Lord in prayer as we begin. Lord, thank you for your word, Lord, that instructs us as to how you want us to be. I mean, Lord, there's no ambiguity, there's no confusion, and there's certainly no compromise. Lord, you have standards for us, your people. You have standards for us as we minister, serve in your holy name. Lord, we want to be a people who aspire to reach those qualities. We're not going to be perfect. But Lord, we want to be people of discipline. We want to train ourselves to godliness. We want to avoid all ungodliness. And Lord, we want to be part of that line of wonderful godly men and women throughout history, church history, who were excellent ministers, excellent servants of Christ Jesus. We pray for your blessings now in our study, in Jesus' name, amen. Okay, let's open our Bibles, please. Let's go to 1 Timothy chapter 4 as we continue our verse-by-verse study through 1 Timothy. As you can see on the screen behind me, today we're going to be focusing on verses 7 through 9 in our second of what will probably be a several-part series entitled The Absolute Necessity for Excellent Ministers of Christ Jesus. Now, I think it's fair to say that all of us would like to be excellent in something, right? Some of you ladies may want to be excellent wives. Some of you ladies are excellent wives. Some of you may want to be excellent in how you serve your family, how you serve your friends, how you serve your community, how you serve your church. Men, I think it's fair to say we'd like to be excellent, right? We'd like to be excellent when it comes to feeding people God's truth. We'd like to be excellent when it comes to leading God's people according to God's truth. We'd like to be excellent when it comes to shepherding the flock of God. We'd like to be excellent when it comes to stewarding God's finances. I think it's fair to say we all want to be excellent, right? And wanting to be excellent is not a negative or prideful thing as long as you want to be an excellent servant of Christ Jesus. And in our section that we're studying now, that's what the Apostle Paul is teaching young Timothy, who is pastoring there in the church of Ephesus, or even churches of Ephesus, maybe. He's in a tough situation. Again, you know the story. Paul had once ministered in this glorious church of Ephesus. He actually helped found it and grow it. He'd been there 3 years, longest time Paul had ministered in any church that he had planted. It was during his third missionary journey. Paul was there in Ephesus, and we're told in Acts 19:10, you don't have to turn to it, that Paul's ministry was so powerful that everybody in Asia Minor heard the word of God. Again, Asia Minor, very pagan place, right? You know Ephesus? It was famous for having what was called the seventh wonder of the ancient world. What was that? The temple to Diana or Artemis up on the hill there. We believe it housed over 1,000 pagan female prostitutes. They would do their worshiping during the day there in the temple, and then they would come down at night into the city and do their service when it came to their pagan god, goddess. Well, Paul ministered there for 3 years. And as Paul was leaving in Acts 20, we remember, he had warned the elders there saying, hey, you guys have to stay strong on biblical truth. You need to be excellent ministers, excellent elders. Why? Because Paul said, wolves from the outside, false teachers, are going to want to come in and devour God's flock, God's people. He said, in fact, even among your own number, meaning elders within the church, some wolves are going to rise up who are going to try to devour God's flock. Well, fast forward 8 years later, when Paul returned back to that once glorious church. He had taken Timothy, and he found an absolute mess there. The wolves had shown up, and they were on the elder board, teaching false doctrine, which led to all kinds of ungodly behavior. The elders were not serving in the name of Christ. They were serving in the name of self. They were greedy. They were false prophets who were looking for financial profit. And can you imagine elders in the church of Christ devouring the flock of Christ? How are they devouring them? False teaching. That's how Satan works. He works through demonic influence, working through false teachers to devour the flock of God, which, by the way, was purchased by the precious blood of Christ, of which elders have been made overseers by God the Holy Spirit. That's disgusting, wouldn't you agree? And that's how Paul felt when he saw that church. He had to blow up the elder board, excommunicate some of the elders. Paul ended up leaving and going and checking on the other churches that he had planted there in Macedonia. He left Timothy there to continue to clean up the mess. But we know Timothy's background. By temperament, he was rather timid. By age, he was in his mid-30s, we believe, rather young for a pastor elder back then, and in many cases even today as well. And Timothy had a tough time there. I mean, the remaining elders, many were still teaching false doctrine. That's why in chapter 1, Paul says, you got to get rid of them. People in the congregation were looking down on Timothy. They wanted to continue their corrupt behavior during worship services. That's why in chapter 2, Paul said to Timothy, you've got to clean up the worship services. There was young Timothy by himself. And that's why in chapter 3, Paul said, you've got to raise up godly elders and deacons according to God's standards. And then it's here in chapter 4 that Paul says, okay, Timothy, let's get real here. Your ministry is not going to be easy. Why? Verses 1 through 5. Because the Holy Spirit clearly says that in later times, some will abandon the faith. They will become apostates, denying the very biblical faith they had once professed. And instead of following Christ, they're going to follow deceiving spirits and doctrine taught by demons. Ministry's not getting easier, guys. It's getting harder. And those teachings, doctrine of demons, verse 2, are going to come through hypocritical liars, i.e. false teachers, whose consciences have been seared as with a hot iron. They denied the truth of God so much that eventually their consciences did not even react to the truth of God. They were false teachers working for Satan, teaching doctrine of demons, such as verses 3 through 5, they forbid people to marry, which, by the way, is a gift from God. And they ordered people to abstain from certain foods, again, which are gifts from God, which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth. For everything God created is good. And nothing is to be rejected if it's received with thanksgiving because it was concentrated by the word of God. We know marriage is good. We know foods are good because God's word tells us. And our word back to God for his good gifts to us should be what? Prayer. So Paul says to Timothy, Timothy, as he writes this letter, this first letter to Timothy, He says, Timothy, chapter 1, get rid of the false teachers. Chapter 2, clean up the worship services. Chapter 3, raise up godly elders and deacons. Chapter 4, Timothy, here's the deal. It's not going to be. I love Paul here being real with Timothy. Paul was a realist. He didn't just hide behind some sort of like, you know, ideal thing. No, everything's going to be okay. Timothy, ministry should be easy. I, the great apostle Paul, trained you. Timothy, I set an example for you. Timothy, you travel with me on all kinds of missionary trips. Timothy, ministry's not going to be tough. Just hang in there, buddy. Be encouraged. Believe, and you will receive. What your mind conceives, you'll be able to achieve. What? Well, Paul was a realist. Verses 1 through 5, he says, Timothy, you need to understand the absolute certainty of the coming apostasy. Friends, that's the lesson for us as well. Ministry will not get easier because of the demonic influence. The Holy Spirit clearly says that. Because of human influence, the demons teaching their doctrines through false teaching humans whose consciences have been seared. All kinds of heretical teachings everywhere that on the surface may seem kind of holy. Well, I'm not going to get married. Well, I'm not going to eat these foods because I'm going to show everybody how holy I am. Really? You want to set higher standards than God had set? And remember, we saw that quote from commentator William Barclay, who said, throughout history, men have always tried to be holier than God by setting standards that they can't keep, nor no one else can keep. That's heretical teaching, right? Adding to God's word. Well, then, here in verses 6 through 16, Paul says, okay, Timothy, you know about the absolute certainty of the coming apostasy, Timothy. That's why there's the absolute necessity for excellent ministers of Christ Jesus. And it's here in this section that Paul gives 11 qualities of an excellent minister. Friends, you want to be excellent in something? Learn these 11 qualities and become that type of person as you serve in the name of Christ Jesus. Be excellent in that. And as we remember from our teaching last week, the key part, the anchor verse in verses 6 through 16 that really explains this whole passage is verse 6, part B. You will be a good what? Minister. This is the anchor right here. This tells us what Paul is teaching to Timothy, which Timothy needed to teach the people in the church, and which we, as God's people, need to learn how to be a good minister. Remember, we learned in the Greek last week, the word good is kalos, which literally means excellent, admirable. And we learned the word minister, diakonos, which means servant. Not talking about the office of deacon here, he's talking about servants in general. So again, in our immediate context here, Paul is teaching Timothy, who is to teach elders, what God's qualities are for an excellent minister, pastor, elder, right? That's the immediate context. So again, those of you who aspire to become ordained pastor, elders, God says, here are 11 qualities that he says are kalos, excellent. But again, as we talked last week, the word for minister, servant, diakonos, is general. So I don't feel we should just limit this section to God's standards for excellent pastors, what he looks for in an excellent pastor. But I think it's fair to say that even those of you who do not ever foresee yourselves being ordained and being elders and pastors, nevertheless, are you servants of Christ? Right? Do you want to be excellent according to God's qualities and standards? Yeah. So guess what? I think all of us need to understand what God says about being an excellent minister. Would you agree with that? And remember last week we learned the first three of the 11 qualities. We saw that an excellent minister is a protecting shepherd. Verse 6, part A. If you point these things out to the brothers and sisters, you'll be a good minister of Christ Jesus. Point what things out? What we just read in verses 1 through 5. The reality of the coming apostasy. Listen, you want to be an excellent minister, an excellent servant of Christ Jesus? You cannot be afraid to warn God's people. Listen, you don't want to build a negative ministry where all you do is give done a warning, bad news, bad news, bad news. No. But you don't want to make the mistake of giving nothing but fluffy good news that tickle people's ears. You've got to warn God's people of sin, of God's discipline. You've got to warn people of God's wrath. You've got to warn people of the reality of the coming apostasy. You've got to warn people that you don't play around and disobey God's word. You need to warn people about the dangers of coming in close to Christ and hearing all about Christ and then just walking away, because then you're following deceiving spirits. You've got to give people the whole truth, the full counsel of truth. And you trust that God will provide the balance in his word of encouragement and warning. And do not shy away from warning people. You've got to lay these things out before them and do it on a consistent basis. Because I think you'll agree, when we think everything's okay, we just slowly take steps out into the world, which is filled with demonic landmines. So an excellent servant, according to God, is a protecting shepherd. God's entrusted people to you, whether you're a pastor, pastoring a church, elders, you know, leading a church, whether you're leading a small group, whether it's one-on-one, you need to protect the sheep God's entrusted to you. Number two, an excellent minister, according to God's standards, an excellent servant, is a humble servant. Second part of verse B, you'll be an excellent minister of Christ Jesus. And remember, we learned Paul used an example of what a humble servant looked like. He referred to himself in 1 Corinthians 4 as a third level galley slave, chained to a seat, chained to an oar, and he just kept rowing for Christ. That's the attitude you have to have. Apostle Paul didn't walk around and say, look at me, I'm the great Apostle Paul. He said, I'm a third level galley slave. Why? He said, because I'm a servant of Christ Jesus. Paul understood he wasn't the star. It was all about Christ. You want to be an excellent minister, an excellent servant of Christ Jesus? You need to know who the boss is, who the master is, who the captain of the ship is, and you need to view yourself and even have others view you as a huperetes, third level galley slave, just row for Christ. And then number three, as we learned last week, an excellent minister, an excellent servant is a serious student. As my wife showed me yesterday, she came downstairs with about this many books and Bibles. She said, where are you going? She said, I'm going downstairs. I said, why are you going downstairs? She said, because I need peace. I'm a serious student. Who, by the way, verse 6, part C, nourishes himself or herself on the truths of the faith and of the good teaching, sound doctrine, and God's word. Again, if you have nothing in you that is good, i.e. sound doctrine, you have nothing to give to somebody else. So let me ask all of you a question before we go to our next two qualities. Over this past week, have you been excellent according to God's standards as a minister, servant of Christ Jesus? Have you protected those God has entrusted to you, warned them, laid before them God's truth, including warnings? Or did you just want to be accepted and popular? Or didn't want to deal with the headache of warning people? Have you been a humble servant? Especially when other people have actually treated you like a third-level galley slave. I mean, it's great in theory when you see the great Apostle Paul saying he's a third-level galley slave, but how is it in reality when someone treats you like that? Have you been a serious student, or did you let the busyness of life get in the way of serious study of the truths of the faith and of the sound doctrine God has given us? It's very interesting how we go through our lives either listening to what other people say an excellent servant of Christ Jesus is, or even what our own opinions say to us as to what an excellent servant of Christ Jesus is. You see how we start to compromise or get lazy or even justify? Hey, I'm doing some excellent work here. Yeah, according to whose standards? God's standards are clear. Would we not say that? We know that of the certainty of the coming apostasy, right? We should agree with the then absolute necessity for excellent ministers, right? Well, where are the excellent servants going to come from? Oh, I know, the world of non-believers who want nothing to do with Christ? Or are the excellent ministers, excellent servants going to be raised up from within the body of Christ? So this challenge of excellence in God's eyes for you and for me is for us. And don't you dare let the world set the standard as to what excellence is and what you do in serving Christ. There's no ambiguity here, is there? It's clear. Let's go on to our next two points. Today, verses 7 through 9, Paul gives us two more points of what an excellent minister is. He says, have nothing to do with godless myths and old wives' tales. Rather, train yourself to be godly. For physical training is of some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and the life to come. This is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. An excellent minister, servant of Christ Jesus, is not only a protecting shepherd, a humble servant, and a serious student. Verse 7, part A, an excellent minister avoids ungodly influences. Which then leads to verse 7, part B, through verse 9, an excellent minister trains for godliness. 5 of the 11 qualities. Let's look at number 4. Verse 7, part A. Go ahead and underline some words. Paul says to Timothy, have nothing to do. Underline that. Have nothing to do. have nothing to do with what? Godless, underline godless. Myths, underline myths. And old wives' tales, I would underline that. Here we go in the Greek. You want to be an excellent minister, an excellent servant? You have got to protect your mind. You have to avoid, have nothing to do with pedai thelmai. Reject, refuse. Is that being passive or active? Active. Semi-active or very aggressively active? Have nothing to do with. To do with what? Godless, bebelos, unholy, profane, worldly things and influences. Such as myths, mouthos, we learned this word before, fables, fiction, things that are lies, including those things that we call half-lies, which, by the way, are lies. There's no such thing as a small little white lie. A lie is a lie. It's a mouthos. Have nothing. Reject, refuse that which is bebelos, unholy, profane, worldly, such as mouthos, fables, and fiction, and watch this, and old wives' tales. Graudais, it literally means old womanish. Back then, women largely were uneducated, right? And thus were often considered unsophisticated, especially the older women who had no schooling, you know. As they got older, they were uneducated, they became more unsophisticated to the point of even being senile. And you can imagine the picture of what an old baba who was kind of senile, the story she tells to young children. doesn't make sense. There's no ad. In fact, a lot of times it's very confusing and even a lie. You want to be an excellent minister, servant of Christ Jesus? You have to avoid, reject, refuse all ungodly, bebelos influences that are coming for your mind. Now, in this context, that was pretty tough for Timothy, wasn't it? Because look what the false teachers were teaching in that church. Just hop over to chapter 1, verses 3-5. And when Paul wrote this letter, he says, Timothy, I urge you when I went into Macedonia to stay there in Ephesus so that you may command certain people not to teach false doctrines anymore or to devote themselves to what? Mouthos, you see it? What were they teaching? These elders who were false teachers. Fiction, fables, including genealogies, you know, all kinds of stuff of their own thinking. Paul says such things promote controversial speculations rather than advancing God's work, which is by faith. You see, those false teachers, you know how they were corrupting the church? They were not avoiding ungodly influences. They were bringing that into the church. Bebelos, unholy, profane, worldliness. Mouthos, genealogies. All kinds of things that they go, oh, I think this, or I'm speculating on this. They were like a bunch of starababas, like a senile starababa who was just talking for the sake of talking. That is what the ungodly false teachers were bringing into God's church. And Paul says to Timothy, it's going to get worse, the absolute certainty of the coming apostasy. That's why Timothy, you, and everybody who reads this needs to understand the absolute necessity for excellent ministers of Christ Jesus. Look, you can be a humble servant. You can try and aspire to be excellent. But if you do not protect your mind, eventually, you will become an instrument through which Bebelos comes to God's people. And that's why Paul said to Timothy in chapter 6 of 1 Timothy, his closing two verses to him, Timothy, guard what has been entrusted to your care. What is he talking about there? Look. Sound doctrine. Turn away from godless chatter and opposing ideas, which is falsely called knowledge, which some have professed, and in doing so have, you see it, committed apostasy. John MacArthur says, the mind is a precious thing, for God expects those in leadership to have a pure mind, one saturated with his word. Remember, one of the qualities you got to be a serious what? Student, nourishing yourself constantly. There's no place for foolish, silly myths that are in reality doctrine of demons. You have to avoid at all cost ungodly influences. And I'm going to tell you this right now. It's not about avoiding ungodly behavior. It starts with avoiding ungodly influences in your mind. Because what you believe eventually shows itself in your behavior. You get your beliefs right, your behavior comes right. You get your beliefs wrong, i.e. ungodly influences coming at you, your behavior will eventually be ungodly. So you've got to protect your mind. You need a pure mind. Again, hop over to 2 Timothy, Paul's last letter he ever wrote under the inspiration of the Spirit. This was during his second imprisonment. Look at verses 14 through 16 of chapter 2. He says to Timothy, keep reminding God's people of these things. Warn them before God against quarreling about words, because it has no value. It only ruins those who listen. Do your best to present yourself to God as a one approved, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, but who correctly handles the word of truth. Avoid godless chatter, verse 16, because those who indulge in it will become more and more what? Ungodly. If you don't avoid ungodly influence, eventually you're going to become ungodly. Avoid the godless chatter, because those who indulge in it will become more and more ungodly. Their teaching will what? Spread like gangrene. You guys know what gangrene is, huh? That's a beautiful picture, isn't it? You want to spread that in God's church? Amongst God's people? No. Then what do you need to do? Be an excellent minister. Not only a protecting shepherd, not only a humble servant, but also a serious student who avoids all ungodly influences. Does that make sense? That's why in our seminary, I'm not allowing curriculum to come in here where you guys study dead Germans. You know, the dead Germans who brought in liberalism, humanism. I don't want you to become experts on dead Germans. Now, I'm not talking about all Germans. Someone's going, whoa, he doesn't like German people. No, no, no. If you know and understand church history, the recent gangrene that has spread throughout Christianity in the last, 150, 200 years is from German liberal theology, which a lot of seminaries force their students to study. Seriously? I need to become an expert on Bultmann? A guy who denied Christ, miracles in the Bible? Have you ever studied Bultmann? Yes. Have you? No, I'm not talking about you. Have you? Okay. You know right now what I just said in 2 seconds, all you need to know about Bultmann. Why would I put your minds and expose your mind to that ungodliness to study him? So our seminary is never going to have that. I need to protect your minds from ungodly influence. You see what I'm saying? I want you to become workmen approved who correctly handle God's word. Right? Workmen approved by God, who are not ashamed before God, but who accurately, correctly become people of the book, not people of dead German liberal theologians. Another thing you're not going to study in our seminary, the culture. Oh yeah, I had classes when I went to seminary back in the Neanderthal ages. I had classes where we were expected to exegete the culture. We just read 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 through 5, the absolute certainty of the coming apostasy. That's all you need to know about the culture. Is it getting better or worse? Worse. Okay, you need more to study about the demonic influence? You need to study about demons and the devil? That's the culture. I'm going to put your minds around that? Study that, study that, study that. What? No. Did you ever exegete the culture? You didn't even know what the word exegete meant in English, right? Okay. Do you now understand the culture? Yeah. How long did it take for you to understand that? All of 5 seconds. You don't need to study anymore. Here's what you need to study. This. That's why I keep saying it, and I keep saying it, and I keep saying it. You better be careful. Finish my sentence. With social media. You are exposing your minds to bebelos, ungodly influences. You are. You're exposing your minds to other people's opinions, myths, old wives' tales. You're exposing yourself to visuals that once they get stuck in your mind, they go into your heart. It's going to come out in your actions. You're exposing yourselves to false teaching that is masked behind certain verses from the Bible or Christianese talk. Think about your minds over the last week. Did you spend more time in God's word or more time on social media? What did you expose your mind to? And if the answer is it was more on social media, you became an excellent servant of social media. And I'm sure you can come up here and tell me everything you learned on social media. Let me ask you something. Is any of that godly? Or let me just say, I think you'll agree with this because I'm not on social media. The vast majority of it is probably ungodly. Would you agree with that? Yeah. Back to 1 Timothy. Now again, I don't want you guys to think that I'm against technology and I'm living in the old ages. No, no, no. Just because I don't know how to use technology, but I do know what the Bible says. One of the qualities that God says is an excellent minister, verse 7, part A, is that you have nothing to do with. You reject, you refuse what? Godlessness. Bebelos. Such as myths, like fiction and fables and genealogies and old wives' tale, senile talk from ungodly people. That's quality number four. Pretty clear, isn't it? But we're going to look at one other quality today. An excellent minister not only has to be active when it comes to avoiding ungodly influences, an excellent minister needs to be active when it comes to training. Training himself for what? The next bodybuilding contest? No. Training himself so that he can take one of those, what are those things called, selfies? So that he can take a picture of himself or herself and post it on social media? Are you kidding me, people? You look at that stuff? No, you need to train yourself for what? Godliness. Part B. Well, let's just read all of verse 7. Have nothing to do with godless myths and old wives' tales. You understand that. Rather, here's the transition statement, train, underline the word train, yourself to be what? Godly. I underline the word godly. Let's look in the Greek. Train. Gymnase. This is where we get our English words, gymnasium, gymnastics. It literally means train, be disciplined. But the way it's structured in the ending here in the Greek, it's in the continuous tense, present tense. It means you need to continuously, constantly train with effort. What? Yourself to be Eusebia. Godly, reverent, a person of piety, a person who has true spiritual virtue towards whom? God first, and then man. And I love this word, godly, Eusebia. It's one of the words Paul uses frequently in the three pastoral letters. Why? Because he's talking to two young pastors, Timothy and Titus. And let's face it, if you want to get rid of ungodliness, you've got to be godly and teach godly doctrine. In fact, just hop over to chapter 6. You'll see how he uses Eusebia, verse 6, when it comes to money. But Eusebia, piety, reverence, true spiritual virtue with contentment is great gain rather than trying to fill your pockets with all kinds of money. In that context. Verse 11, but you, man of God, flee from all this ungodliness and pursue righteousness and what else? Eusebia. You see, you flee and you pursue. John Stott says, godly people are God-fearing people. Not fear like, oh. No, we know from Romans that for whom the Father has chosen before the foundation of time, those whom Christ redeemed 2,000 years ago at the cross, are those who have been regenerated by God the Holy Spirit, indwelt by God the Holy Spirit, sealed by God the Holy Spirit, and we no longer have a spirit of fear, but we have the spirit of sonship, where we can call God our heavenly Abba Father. That's not the fear he's talking about, like fear, like, oh, judgment. No, it is reverence. It is worship. It's understanding God is God and that you're not. Godly people are God-fearing people. And nothing evokes the worship of God like the what? Word of God. Do you see why I take you so deeply in Scripture? I'm the worship leader here. Actually, God's word is by His Spirit. Train yourself to be godly. Well, how do you do that? Well, let's hop real quick to Philippians. Chapter 4. Look at verses 8 and 9. Paul says, Here's how you train yourself to be godly. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Do you see that? How do you train yourself to be godly? Look, is this excellent, praiseworthy, noble? This is where you got to train yourself to think on this. Avoid ungodly influences. Train yourself like an athlete. Again, think about in the Greek culture. Every Greek city had a gymnasium. You had the Greeks, they highly prized athletics. Aren't they the ones who started the Greek Olympic Games? Yeah. So Paul says, look, if you're going to train Timothy, you want to train yourself to be godly, Eusebia. Reverence towards God, piety towards God, spiritual virtue. How do I do that? You've got to think on those things that are excellent, praiseworthy, noble. God's word. And then you're able to say, verse 9, whatever you've learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, just put it into practice, you see? That's true discipleship there. Your life is Eusebia, godly. Then you can say to other people, just follow my example as I follow Christ, and the God of peace will be with you. That's why Paul says in Romans, you know this verse right here, Romans 12, 1 through 2. How do you train yourself to be godly? Verses 1 through 2, Paul says, therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, in view of everything Paul talked about in the first 11 chapters of Romans, the bad news, that we're under God's judgment, the good news, that Christ came to be judged in our place and to pay for our sins. In view of God's mercy, what should be our response? To offer our bodies, the totality of our being, as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to whom? God. Christian, this is your true, reasonable, rational act of worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world. Avoid all godly, ungodly influences. But rather, be transformed. How? Train towards godliness. What are you training? Your mind. Then, here's the result. You're going to be in shape from all that training. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Train yourself towards godliness. And oh, by the way, we have no excuses. Why? Go to 2 Peter chapter 1. Verses 3 through 9. Actually, let's go verses 3 through 11. His, meaning God's divine power has given us Christians everything we need for what kind of life? Godly. Hello, Eusebia. God's power has given you, Christian, everything you need to live a godly life through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. Through these, he has given us great, very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature, having escaped the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. For this reason, the fact that God, Christian, has given you through his divine power everything you need to train yourself for godliness? For this very reason, what are the next three words? Make every effort. Discipline yourself. Train yourself to add to your faith, saving faith, goodness, and to goodness, knowledge, and to knowledge, self-control, and to self-control, perseverance, and to perseverance, godliness, and to godliness, mutual affection, and to mutual affection, love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, if you train, you should start to see gain. If you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you, Christian, from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. But whoever does not have these, you're nearsighted and blind. You're forgetting that you've been cleansed from your past sins. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, make every effort to confirm your calling and election. For if you do these things, you'll never stumble, and you will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Is there an excuse for us not to train to be godly? No, because God has given us everything we need to be able to train to be godly. We know where it starts. It starts with your mind. That's why you focus on that and you continually dedicate yourself to that which is noble, pure, and excellent and praiseworthy. This is your spiritual act of worship, Christian. In view of God's mercy, you don't conform to the ungodly influences. You avoid them, refuse them, reject them. And rather, you transform yourself. How? By the renewing of your mind. And you have everything you need. You have the Word of God, you have the Spirit of God. But it takes effort. You can't just sit there. I mean, you think of these guys that were training for the Olympics back then and even today. Do they have discipline? Do they train hard? That's why Paul said 1 Corinthians chapter 9. I love this, verses 24 through 27. I love this picture here. He says, don't you know that in a race all runners run, but only one gets the prize? Christian, run in such a way to get the prize. You are in it to win it, to be excellent. Not average, excellent minister of Christ Jesus. Everyone who goes, who competes in the games, talking about the Olympic or Corinthian games they had there, they go into strict training. And they do it to get a crown that's not going to last. But we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Therefore, Paul says, I don't run like someone running aimlessly. I don't just run around like some sort of chicken on the farm. He says, I don't fight like a boxer just beating the air. He says, no, I'm focused. No, I'm disciplined. No, I train hard. He says, I strike a blow to my body. Like, I'm putting my sin nature under control. How does that happen when you're filled with the Spirit? How are you filled with the Spirit? When the Word of God richly dwells on the throne of your heart. No, I strike a blow to my body and I make it a slave so that after I preach to others, I myself might not be disqualified from the prize, meaning he loses his position of preaching because of some stupidity of allowing ungodly influence into him that eventually leads into ungodly behavior. It's called strict training. Back to 1 Timothy as we close. Verse 7, have nothing to do with godless myths and old wives' tales. Rather, train yourself to be godly. And then he gives a great example. It's actually an axiom or proverbial statement. For physical training is of what? Some, underline some. Some value. I think Paul's maybe taken a shot at the overzealous aesthetic false teachers. You know, those false teachers we read about in verses 1 through 5 who were forbidding people to marry and eat certain foods. They were like, you know, those people back then, the super extreme aesthetics, they thought that you were created, you have a body and a soul, but they were in opposition to each other. That the body was like this evil prison that housed your soul. And the true salvation is that through your mind, that's what the Gnostics taught, through your mind and the secrets of Gnosticism, you could free your soul from this evil prison called your body and be saved. I think Paul takes a shot at these Gnostics, these early form of Gnostics and ascetics, where he says, hey, physical training, hello, has value. Your body's not evil. Again, as Christians, we believe, right? We have two parts, right? Body and soul. We believe they're not in opposition to each other. We believe that God in his grace has united them through his creation. And we believe that as Christians, we want to train our souls to be godly. But it's okay to train your body, right? Because Christian, God the Holy Spirit lives in you, and your body is a temple of the living Lord. So he says, for physical training is of some value, but Eusebia, godliness, has value for what? All things, underline all things. Holding promise for both the present life, underline present life, and the life to come, underline life to come. So he says, look, Timothy, you want to be an excellent minister? He says, you need to avoid ungodly influences. And number two, you need to, at least for our section today, you need to train yourself for godliness. It takes discipline. It takes effort. But there's no excuse. God has provided us everything we need so that we can do that. And it starts with your mind. And oh, by the way, Timothy, just like physical training, verse 8, has some value because it's really just limited to your body and for this life, godliness, eusebia, has all value. Why? Because it's for your body and soul, mind, emotions, everything. Not just for this life, but for the life to come. So I know you guys started a training club at the gym and all that. That's great. It has some value. But if that training takes you away from true spiritual training, you're wasting your time. Because what you're doing only lasts in this lifetime in terms of physical training. You're going to get a new body, Christian. And by the way, as you get older, trust me, all that training, because I used to do all that too. Train yourself to be godly, for physical training is of some value, but godliness has value for all things. Holding promise for both the present life and the life to come. That's a proverbial axiomatic statement. And he confirms it in verse 9 by saying, this is a trustworthy saying. I don't believe he's talking about what we're going to study next week, verse 10, as being that trustworthy saying. I believe he's concluding this part by saying, just like physical training has some value, he says, but godliness has value for all things, this life and the life to come. This is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Do you see that? And it's true, isn't it? That kind of proverbial statement he made in verse 8, physical training's okay, but training for godliness is much better. It's kind of a proverbial statement, axiomatic statement. Kind of like one you guys are familiar with. Garbage in, garbage out. If you're training for godliness, that's called exercise for godliness, right? What is key, Yosef, to be able to exercise properly for godliness? What you eat. Isn't it interesting? Paul had said what we studied last week, end of verse 6, nourish yourselves on the truths of the faith and of the good teaching that you have followed. You see? Good, healthy, spiritual food, nourishing yourself on sound doctrine, is going to allow you to train excellently with a lot of effort for godliness. Garbage in, garbage out. What do you mean by that, Andrew? Well, if you don't pay attention to what we learned to today, verse 7, part A, if you allow and don't avoid bebelos muthos and old wives' tales, if you don't avoid at all cost ungodly influences, you are allowing garbage to come in. And let me ask you something. What kind of training is going to come out of that? Healthy spiritual food leads to healthy, disciplined spiritual training, which leads to Eusebia. Unhealthy spiritual food, ungodly influences coming into your mind, you're going to have, even if you choose to train, you're going to have a terrible workout. You're not going to have discipline, dedication, and you're not going to be able to train yourself to godliness. And the result is going to be ungodliness. Paul said to Timothy, Timothy, you want to be an excellent minister, servant of Christ Jesus? Number one, you need to be a protecting shepherd. Number two, you need to be a humble servant of Christ Jesus. Number three, you need to be a serious student of God's word. Number four, you have to reject, refuse, avoid at all costs ungodly influences, so that number five, you're able to train yourself to Eusebia, godliness. That is what God says an excellent minister is. My hope and prayer for all of us is that we remember not just Paul's proverbial axiomatic statement. Physical training's okay, but training for godliness is much better. I hope we also remember this modern-day proverbial axiomatic statement. Garbage in, garbage out. Let's pray. Oh God, thank you so much for your holy word today and your challenging, convicting, and yet very clear commands as to what you say an excellent minister servant of Christ Jesus is. Lord, we want to be excellent ministers and servants of Christ Jesus. Lord, we have no excuse. We have to train, yeah. It's going to take discipline, yeah. But we have everything we need towards godly, for godliness. So, Lord, may we not be a people of excuses. May we not be a people of compromises. May we not be a people of laziness. Rather, Lord, may we avoid all ungodly influences. May we protect our minds. And may we train ourselves for godliness, remembering the healthy spiritual food that comes from your word will lead to disciplined, healthy exercise towards godliness. Help us to be that excellent ministers in service of Christ Jesus, we pray in Jesus' name.